To day three of the Fields Medal Symposium this year. So maybe before we get started, just a quick reminder. So if you have any questions, please feel during the talk, please feel free to put them in the chat, and then there can be a discussion. And then at the end of the talk, we'll collect all the questions for the speaker as well. Okay, so without further ado, I'm very happy to introduce Yves André to kick things off today from University of Sorbonne. He's going to tell us about the canonical FPQC and finite topologies.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to join this symposium. A few years ago, some officials came to my institute to watch us at work. And my colleague, Benoît Stroh, had the difficult task to present perfectoids to these officials. But he found a very nice expression. So he said that for us, number theorists, it's like a new spring. And in fact, I agree. So in number theory,
inside the talk, there's
a problem. Do you hear me? It's okay, okay. I've opened a new spring, as Benoît said, and this symposium illustrates this in various subfields of number theory, like periodic clutch theory, automorphic representation, and so on, with brand new views towards the future of these fields. But in this talk, I'll take some time to give a look at the past and try to do three things. First, reconsider all open problems from the 60s in algebraic geometry and commutative algebra. Second, to show how the idea of perfectoids has led to solutions. And third, to show in turn how these answers to these old problems lead to new perspectives. So the old problems I have in mind concern mainly finite coverings in algebraic geometry, so finite surjective morphisms. So up to a finite covering by Noether normalization theorem, any sequence of nested subvarieties of an affine algebraic variety just looks like a flag of vector space. So up to finite coverings, everything is flattened. This is flatland. So understanding this up to is therefore a primary motivation for studying in depth finite coverings. So this talk is in great part based on a joint work with Luisa Fiorot from Padova, which is to appear in the Annali della Scuola Normale Superiore di Pisa. I read on the website that the scientific program of this symposium is intended for a wide audience, including graduate students, mathematicians in other research areas, and so on. So that's a difficult task, but I try to take this advice in account and start with very basic things at a very slow pace. So I start by some comments on the base change and descent. So we fix a ring map alpha from R to S and consider the base change functor alpha star, which is just a tensor product with S from the category of module over R to the category of S module. So since we have a framework of abelian categories, three properties of this functor, which have to be considered: exactness, faithful exactness, or faithfulness. So if this base change functor is exact, it means that says that alpha is flat. If it is faithful exact, alpha is faithfully flat, And if alpha star is faithful, then this is a poor relative in algebraic geometry. One rarely considers this property. But in a commutative algebra, the name for such an alpha is pure. So that one immediately sees that faithfully flat is the same as flat plus pure. Now, what is purity? Some criteria. First, purely ring theoretic criteria is that alpha is pure if and only if it is universally injective, which means that it remains injective after any base change. Another partial criterion is that if alpha splits as a map of R module in mod R, so that is, if R is the direct summon of the R module S, then alpha is pure. And there is a partial converse to this in two very important cases. So this is a classical proposition. The converse is true if either the quotient S over R as an R module is finitely presented, or the second case is when R is a complete Noetherian local ring. Another criterion, which is very old, one can find it in Bourbaki, if there is some S module M which is faithfully flat over R, then alpha is pure. And it was a long-standing open question by Ferrand, Daniel Ferrand, about the converse. Is it true that the converse, if alpha is pure, is there some module over S which is faithfully flat over R? So this is solved in our paper, but I shall talk about this a little later. So now let's speak about reverse base change, that is descent. So there's this notion of descent data, so which is an S module and plus an isomorphism between two tensor product with S on the right or on the left, satisfying the usual cocycle relations. So this descent data form a category, which are known by DD alpha. The objects are just pairs of S modules and such isomorphism phi. And the base change functor alpha star factors through this category. So there is a comparison functor C alpha, which goes from mod R to the descent data. And then you just forget phi, and there is a functor from the descent data to the S module. Now, the famous Grothendieck descent theorem is that if alpha is faithfully flat, then this comparison functor, C alpha, is an equivalence. A less well-known result is Olivier's descent, which dates back from the 70, is that it says that actually flatness is irrelevant in this story. So in fact, alpha is pure if and only if this comparison morphism is an equivalence, or also if and only if it is fully faithful. So this result was long overlooked and was published only as an announcement in a not a compte-rendu, and it was rediscovered independently several times, but several methods. In our paper, we tried to reconstruct this proof in detail. We started with a hint given in the note, certain key lemma. So we did it, but of course, you might ask, how are you sure that this reconstruction is really Olivier's proof? So, well, at least we have a witness. Ferrand had Olivier's details in the hands long ago, and told us that actually our proof, our reconstruction of Olivier's proof matches his memory. So now, of course, speaking about flatness or faithful flatness, there is no need to comment about the geometric meaning in algebraic geometry after Grothendieck's work. But what is the geometric meaning of purity? The pure relative. This is best expressed in terms of Grothendieck topologies as follows. So, let me call the difference between Grothendieck pretopology and Grothendieck topology because it will be essential in the sequel of the talk. So C is now a category with an initial object and fiber products. And our main example will be the category of affine schemes of a commutative ring K, basically. So Grothendieck pretopology is a class of covering families Y I to X in C, so morphism in C, which contains isomorphism, which is stable by base change and by composition. And a Grothendieck topology is a Grothendieck pretopology, which is saturated in the sense that any family which is refined by a covering family is already a covering family. So some examples, the FPQC pretopology on affine scheme, okay, as for covering maps, all faithfully flat maps. Whereas the FPQC topology, in contrast, is given as follows. So a covering map Y to X is a map such that there exists Z over Y, such that the composition Z to Y to X is faithfully flat. So Y to X is, may not be faithfully flat. Another example is the effective descent topology on affine scheme. Okay. The covering families are those for which the corresponding comparison functors, which we saw before, C alpha, are all equivalences. And another example, which will be fundamental for the sequel, is a canonical topology. See, this is the finest Grothendieck topology such that all representable pre-sheaves are sheaves, which means that for all covering families, yi to x, the standard exact sequence is fx product of fyi, double map to the product of f of yi cross over x, y, j is exact for all representable f. By Yoneda, in the case of a single map, y to x, this just means that for all object z in C, in the category C, the triple product y cross z, double map to y cross z, map to z is a co-equalized. Terminology, so I will use the convenient terminology, canonical covering, to say that, to speak about coverings for the canonical topology. But I will not use the terminology FPQC covering because it is ambiguous. It can, usually it means covering for the FPQC pre-topology. But in this talk, it will important object will be the covering for the FPQC topology. So I will say in each case, insist that and say coverings for the FPQC topology. So what about the canonical topology on affine case schemas? So the basic fact is that morphism from spec S to spec R, in this category, is a canonical covering if and only if R to S, so ring map, is pure. So the issue is to prove that something is an equalizer. So for we have to prove that if alpha is pure, then for any S algebra T, this exact sequence from T to S tensor T to double mark to S tensor T is exact. To prove this, one has to look more generally in a category of R module, so construct analogous sequence, M, M is S module, to S tensor M, to double map to S tensor M, where the double map is given by one is the first one is just the space change for S tensor M, and the second one is identity of S tensor, the base change on for M. So why looking at modules? It's because we can construct the equalizer of these two maps. I call it K. And then one look at the following diagram, where the vertical maps are just the base change map for M or for S on the left, or for S tensor M on the right. And I write on the bottom the co-kernel of this base change. Because alpha is pure, the bottom horizontal map is an injection. And for this reason, one sees that the map from K to S tensor M actually factors through M, which is exactly saying, which amounts to say that this exact sequence M to S tensor M to S tensor M is an equalizer. So by now by this transcription of the traduction of the canonical topology with in terms of purity, reconsidering Olivier's result, Olivier's result can be translated into the fact that the canonical topology is exactly the effective descent topology. So in the 70s, again, Ferrand asked another question: is the canonical topology equal to the FPQC topology? And soon after, in their famous paper, Leno and Rouzon answered that it is not the case. So we speak about this later. So two remarks. This topological interpretation of purities is also useful to globalize to non-affine schemes. But I will not insist on this because in the non-affine case, it is no longer the case that finite coverings, which are canonical, split the level of the OX, the structural shape OX to OY, viewed as OY viewed as an OX module. It's no longer the case in the non-affine. So another comment is that for a long time, only subcanonical topology were considered to be relevant in algebraic arithmetic geometry. Subcanonical means so weaker than the canonical topology. But why was he changed this viewpoint and introduce several Grothendieck topologies in the context of motivic homotopy, which are not weaker than the canonical topology. The point, so there are two reasons, in fact, to do this. One reason is that some topologies, which are finer than the canonical topology, are very nice because what we have compute their points explicitly, rather their local rings, which is, for instance, not at all the case for the FPPF topology, which is subcanonical, of course. Another later motivation, which was in Peter Scholz's work, that some grotonic topology which are not subcanonical have very nice descent, very strong cohomological descent properties. For instance, there is this V topology where covering maps are so maps Y to X, so that valuation rings of X lift to valuation of Y. And so and there is also the arc topology studied by Martin Mathieu, which is defined similarly but restricted to rank one valuation ring. So the B topology plays a role in the geometric periodic Langlais program. And the arc topology plays an important role, for instance, in prismatic theories. A small comment, historical comment. In fact, the V topology, which is stronger than the FPQC topology, already appeared long ago in a Picabes work from the 80s. So with a very strange name, it was universally substrusive topology. And also the finer arc topology also made a cameo appearance in Picabes' work. So it corresponds to universally spectrally submersive topology. So, but of course, Picabes was only motivated by some categorical feature of the category of affine scheme over K, especially the description of monomorphism and so on. And he missed completely their powerful descent properties. And so this is another story. But let me come back to finite coverings, which means finite surjective morphism in the category of affine scheme over K. So, what is the basic question I would like to address is the behavior of finite covering with respect to the canonical or to the FPQC topologies. So the first question is about to whether there are some examples of non-canonical finite coverings, Y to X. Let's say for X affine and notarial. So it's easy to answer. Take the normalization of any non-normal excellent scheme, and you have an example of a finite covering, which is non-canonical. Another example, which is more sophisticated, because if you require that X is normal. So the first example has been given long ago. It's as follows. You take for Y the affine space of dimension 4 over K, where K is a field of characteristic 2, and X is a quotient by a cyclic group with 4 elements acting cyclically on the variable. The point is that this X is not Cohen-Macaulay. This was proven by Marie-José Bertin in 67, whereas a finite canonical covering always descends the Cohen-Macaulay property. Why? This is because if you contemplate this the little diagram at the bottom of the page, so the Cohen-Macaulay properties, that's a multiplication by xi plus 1 on the quotient of S by the first I variable in a second sequence has to be injective. But here you assume that it is the case on the top because S is Cohen-Macaulay, and the vertical maps are injective because R2S is pure. So, further remark that there is no such example in characteristic zero, because in characteristic zero, if X is normal, any finite covering is canonical. The reason is that one may assume that this S is an extension of R, that R and S are integral domains. And then you just construct a retraction by taking the trace and divide it out by the degree. This gives a splitting. So one may be more ambitious and ask whether there is an example of a finite covering which is non-canonical with X regular. The answer is no. So this is the first theorem. Any finite covering of a regular scheme is canonical. Hence, an effective descent morphism. So due to the above interpretation of purity in topological terms, this amounts to exactly to a geometric translation of the famous Dirac-Semann conjecture due to Huxter in 69, which says that any finite extension S of regular ring R splits in R modules, the category of R modules. So this was proved by him in the presence of a base field and by me in general, so 2016, using perfectoid methods. I will come back to this later. Well, I already said that Reynaud-Grouzon proved that canonical topology is not a FPTC topology. But their counterexamples were not finite covering. So one may ask for examples of canonical finite coverings which are not covering for the FPQC topology. So in our paper with Luisa, we give several kinds of examples. So the first kind is somehow inspired by the theory of Frobenius algebras. So one consider a finite R module M and a symmetric bilinear form on it, which is associative in the sense that if you take three elements L, M, N in the module M, then L times B, M, N is B, L, M times N. Then the annihilator of this module kills the quadratic form attached to B, and this quadratic form lives in the ideal J, not by J, which is annihilator of the annihilator of M. Now let us construct a finite extension of S of R by declaring that S is R plus M as R module. And the product is constructed in the standard way using the bilinear form B. So the proposition is that if we have seen that this quadratic form lives in the ideal J, but if it does not live in its square, J square, then the finite canonical covering, spec S to spec R, is not a covering for the FPQC topology. And so the minimal example of such a phenomenon is to take R for R z over 4z, for M z over 2z, viewed as an R module. For the quadratic form, you declare that P of 1, 1 is 2. You construct S to be R plus M as before. And then you find that J is the ideal 2z. So the quadratic form is not in the square of J. And this is an example, the minimal example of this gives rise to the minimal example of an extension of R to S, which is pure, which is finite, but which does not lead to covering for the FPQC topology. But can one find a normal example? An example with X normal? Yes, one can take the quadratic cone, X is spec R, with R, K of X squared, XY, y square in characteristic different from two. And it's double covering y, which is just affine plane, spec of k, x, y. Then since r is just a fixed point of polynomial going in x and y by the z of dot 2z, this is the Dirac summand. But it can be shown, first of all, that this finite covering from the affine plane to X is not a covering for the FPQC topology. And moreover, there is no module over K of X and Y, which is faithfully flat over R. So this gives a negative answer to Ferrand's question. But it is not, the proof is not elementary. In fact, it uses some recent work by Bat, Iyengar, and Ma about a perfectoid analog of Kuhn's flatness criterion, regularity criterion, I should have said. See later. So. Going further, one can ask, as in theorem one, whether there is any example with X regular. The answer is no. In theorem two, any finite covering of a regular scheme is a covering for the FPQC topology. So some remarks. First of all, Y to X is a covering for the FPQC pre-topology, if and only if Y is Cohen-Macaulay in this situation, because X is regular. So that's the theorem only predicts that there is a Z, so that the composite Z to Y to X is faithfully flat. Not that Y to X is faithfully flat. Second remark is that one cannot replace FPQC by FPPF. There are some finite coverings of the affine space in three dimensions, which are not coverings for the FPPF topology. This means that the Z before is not expected to be a finite type and not even Noetherian. The third remark is that this theorem two is actually much stronger than theorem one, because already in characteristic zero, so theorem one was almost trivial. This was this trick of taking the trace and dividing out by the degree. Whereas in this theorem two, in characteristic zero, is deduced from the same theorem in characteristic B using some ultra product techniques. So this theorem two actually is a geometric translation of the existence of big Cohen-Macaulay algebras, which was proved by Uxter and Junicke in the presence of a base field by me in general, a paper of the Dirac summand conjecture. So one reduced to the case where S is a complete local finite extension of the regular ring R by Cohen structure theorem. Then because that not necessarily Noetherian S algebra T is a big Cohen-Macaulay algebra if every second sequence in S becomes regular in T. Because that's a second sequence of parameter, x1, xi, is such that whenever you mod out by xi, the dimension drops by one. And it turns out that this property to be big Cohen-Macaulay algebra is equivalent to the faithful flatness of T over R. So T is an S algebra, but it is a big Cohen-Macaulay R if it is faithful flat. So let me recall my construction. For simplicity, to fix ideas, I will take for R just a ring of formal power series, Zp of x2 and x1, So I start from x2 because I consider that x1 is the parameter p. And s is a reduced finite extension of r. So the first thing to do is to extract some p roots of the parameters again and again, and to construct the perfectoid algebra, which I denote by r infinity, which is zp, p 1 over p infinity, and also the variable r, x2 1 over p infinity, xn 1 over p infinity, and you complete the radical. So now let g be an element of r, such that s of 1 over pg is etal over r of 1 over pg. So discriminant. So then extract again p roots iteratively and take integral closure in the resulting algebra with p inverted. So one gets r infinity infinity, which is an integral closure of this r infinity g 1 over p infinity in the same algebra when you invert p. And as usual, you complete the radical. Turns out that this is again a perfect algebra. And the first pillar of my proof is the flatness lemma, is that this r infinity infinity is almost flat, in the sense of p 1 over p infinity, almost flat over r infinity modulo powers of p. In fact, it's already almost flat. Now, next step is to let S, the finite extension of R, enter the stage, and to define S infinity infinity to be the integral closure of S tensor over R, R infinity infinity in the same algebra when you invert PG. So the second pillar of my proof is the perfectoid Abelian-Karp lemma, which says that this S infinity infinity is almost finite etal in the sense of PG 1 over P infinity, and almost flat over R infinity infinity, at least modulo powers of P. So by it means that by extracting roots of G instead of inverting this discriminant, you have reached an almost etal situation. So now we have an S algebra, S infinity infinity, which is almost isomorphic to a faithfully flat R algebra, at least modulo powers of P. But the issue is that this latter algebra may not contain S itself, the finite extension of R. So the last problem is how to get rid of almost. We are almost finished, but fortunately, there are two tricks to do this. One predated my construction, and is due to Huxter, and there was a later trick due to Gaber to transform this S infinity infinity into a genuine S algebra T, which is faithfully flat over R, which is exactly what we are looking for. And Gaber trick used the idea of ultra powers, so to speak. So you consider the quotient of S infinity infinity to power n, and by the same, so whole sequence of element of S infinity infinity. But you find out by the sequence which are almost everywhere zero. So this is a ring. And you localize this ring by the multiplicative system of all pg to the epsilon n when epsilon n tends to zero. It turns out this t is basically flat over r. This is the t we're looking for. And moreover, it is perfected. So now, some years, maybe some remarks. So the flatness lemma looks somehow surprising or even counterintuitive, because if you look at finite levels, so if you extract only finitely many times p roots of the parameters, then you find that the situation seems to worsen at each step because of a lack of control of this integral closure. There are more and more denominators in P. So not only this flatness lemma does not follow from an approximation process, but conversely, it is even unclear what it does say in turn at finite level. Second, this flatness lemma is very flexible and has been used, for instance, by Barth and Schultz in their prismatic theory to reduce the situation to the perfectoid situation. And the third remark is that both this lemma and the perfectoid Abelian lemma are best understood and were in fact discovered in the setting of deformation of perfectoid spaces. So in the framework of perfectoid geometry, not just the perfectoid rings. Now some years passed and so the techniques improved and now we have another construction due to Bargerbach, very recent construction, which proved a stronger result, stronger means. It allows to take into account all finite extension S at the same time. So here R is an excellent regular domain with P in the radical of R. R plus is the integral closure of R in an algebraic closure of the fraction field of R. And then that theorem is that the periodic completion of this R plus is faithfully flat over R. So this is another T that we were looking for. In characteristic P, this theorem, so there is no periodic completion in that case, and it was due to Huxter unity. So this the proof use new tools like new periodic Riemann-Hilbert functor to Barth and Urey to get first almost result. And then there is always this issue to get rid of almost. And for this, Barth used some prismatic techniques. Frobenius is at disposal in prismatic theory. So a very interesting point in this proof, which has been stated by Bargerbach as a motto, I just copy it. In some situations, local or coherent cohomology classes can be killed by passing to finite covering. So this is a new, very important role of finite coverings in arithmetic geometry, algebraic geometry. So let me say something about Frobenius. This is a Frobenius map in characteristic P, which is often a finite covering, for instance, for scheme of finite type of perfect field. So in characteristic P, the Frobenius map is faithfully flat if and only if X is regular. This is Kuhn's theorem. So one can ask whether one can replace the FPQC pre-topology by the FPQC topology, and indeed it is so. Frobenius is a covering for the FPQC topology if and only if X is regular. Another way to state Kuhn's theorem is to say that if you have a notarian ring R of characteristic P, it is regular if and only if there exists a perfect faithfully flat R algebra. And this was generalized in 2018 in mixed characteristic by Barth, Iyengar, and Ma. I already referred to this paper. And the generalization is as follows, perfectly parallel to the previous statement, in characteristic P, so a notarian periodically complete ring R is regular if and only if there exists a perfectoid faithfully flat R algebra. Just here is, as before, perfectoid means integral perfectoid. So now let me shortly glimpse at the singularity theory in positive and mixed characteristic. So whether the Frobenius map is a canonical covering, so it corresponds to F purity, or the question of Frobenius splitting when Frobenius is finite, was an influential question in the studies of singularities in characteristic P in the 80s, in the 90s, and so on. There is also a related notion, I don't insist, strongly F regular, and F pure and strongly F regular singularities are the exact analogs in characteristic P of log canonical or log terminal singularities in the minimal model product. These now have analogs in the mixed characteristic due to Ma and Schwede, based on theorem 2 with perfectoid techniques in the background, of course. The philosophy here is that Ma and Schwede is that for a resolution of singularities, let's say Z to Y, which is space S in characteristic zero, we have the Grauer-Riemann-Schneider theorem and also local duality, which implies that so this hyper version of a local cohomology of the complex RG lower star OZ is zero for any I for in degree smaller than the dimension of Y. So this is something which looks very much like a big Cohen-Macaulay S algebra, except that it is not an algebra on the nose, but it is an algebra object in the derived category. So this supports their strategy to replace this derived object by a big Cohen-Macaulay S algebra T to study singularities in mixed characteristics. So let me come back to the initial question. Behavior of finite coverings with respect to the canonical topology or to the FPQC topology. So here is the definition. A notarian affine scheme X equals to spec R is said to be a splinter if any finite covering of X is canonical. So equivalently, if any finite extension R to S splits as an R module. When the name splinter. So it's easy to see that any splinter is normal, and theorem one says that any regular X is a splinter. But are there any others? Indeed, there are. In characteristic zero, for instance, any normal X is a splinter by the trick trace divided out by the degree. In characteristic P, any strongly F regular X is a splinter. And conjecturally, the converse is true, in fact. For instance, the quadric cone, which we already encountered, is a splinter in characteristic different from two. A recent and strong theorem is that splinters in positive or mixed characteristic are Cohen-Macaulay. This is a straightforward consequence of the Uxter-Junique-Bat theorem about the periodic completion of R+. And finally, X is a splinter if there exists a canonical covering Y, which is regular. So this is a main supply of splinter, in fact. The proof uses a weakly functorial version of theorem 2. Which now is available in complete generality, weak functoriality of big Cohen-Macaulay algebras. So, but now, what if we replace the canonical topology by the FPQC topology? That is what Kahn must say about FPQC analogs or splinters. The conjecture is that only regular X are FPQC analogs of splinters. So the evidence for this conjecture is that it is true in characteristic P, at least in the F finite case. And this is a straightforward consequence of our enhancement of Kuhn's theorem. It turns out that regularity descends on a map, which are covering for the FPQC topology, as I will comment on the next slide. And our main supply of splinters cannot provide any non-regular FPQC analog of splinters. So let me finish by think that at the beginning of my talk, I said that there is no need to comment about the geometric meaning of flatness or faithful flatness in algebraic geometry after Grothendieck's work. But this was a too hasty comment. In fact, I would like to comment about the meaning of flatness or faithful flatness. In EGA, we find many properties of schemes and morphisms which descend along faithfully flat morphisms. Which means, with respect to the FPQC pre-topology. But we can ask which properties descend with respect to the FPQC topology and not only the pre-topology. For instance, in discussion with Ma, he improved a result of which was in our paper and proved that regularity is an example of a property which descends with respect to the FPQC topology. So if you have a map Y to X, which is covering for the FPQC topology, and if Y is regular, then X is also regular. This is not at all an elementary statement. The proof uses method involved in the perfectoid version of Kuhn's theorem. So while this issue could have been addressed in the 60s already, it brings us back after a long detour to fundamental problems about base change and descent, those problems we started with. So the important thing is not to stop questioning, as Einstein said. So. But I will stop speaking now. Thanks for your attention.
Great, thank you very much. Yeah, are there questions for Eve? So actually, I got a question in the chat. Maybe if Lars is okay with it, I can share it. Okay, I get a thumbs up. So the question was, is there a characterization of ring maps A to B such that the map on spec is surjective? It's a module theoretic characterization, I'm guessing.
Well, I'm almost sure that this question is dealt with in a Picaves work, but I don't know the answer, and I would have to think about it. But Picaves introduced a substructive property in considering this kind of question, in fact. So surrounding question, not only this one. So I don't know. I have to think.
Any further questions? Okay, so if not, let's thank you again.
Thank you.